You're listening to highlights from The David Feldman Show, heard nationwide on Pacifica Radio, or as a podcast on iTunes, Stitcher, and now YouTube. Please subscribe to this channel. For more information, go to davidfeldmanshow.com. Thank you for listening.
The David Feldman Radio Program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.
Last Wednesday, Republican Congressman Steve Scalise was critically wounded on a baseball field along with several others after a lone gunman opened fire with a semi-automatic weapon. In the days that followed, both sides of the aisle came together to remind Americans that we needed to dial back the partisan bickering and be more careful with the way we talk to one another. While few politicians blamed easy access to semi-automatic weapons, everyone agreed that the shooting was really the result of the debasement of our political discourse. After Dr. David Gunn was murdered, he was an abortion provider, nobody asked the pro-life movement to cease and desist, to dial it down, to stop referring to people like Dr. Gunn as baby killers, or giving out his home address, his car make and license number, and providing everything but the ammunition to shoot him. According to last month's New York Review of Books, between the years 1978 and 2015, 11 abortion providers, 9 of them doctors, have been murdered by pro-life extremists. There have been 26 attempted murders of abortion providers. 185 abortion clinics have been set on fire. 42 have been bombed, and 1,534 have been vandalized. Despite the passage of Roe v. Wade in the late 1970s, Supreme Court rulings like Casey versus Planned Parenthood have made it easier for states to limit a woman's access to an abortion. The number of abortion clinics in Texas has been cut in half due to new rules making it financially prohibitive for doctors to perform abortions. Some states now require a mandatory 24-hour waiting period before a woman can have her abortion. Other states force doctors to perform an ultrasound and describe the fetus to the woman before she undergoes the abortion. Last week on the show, we talked with comedian Greg Proops, who traveled to Jackson, Mississippi, to report on the last abortion clinic in all of Mississippi. And if you haven't heard Greg's Proopcast, I urge you to go and listen to it. Greg was also down in Mississippi to perform for Lady Parts Justice League Vagical Mystery Tour hosted by Lizz Winstead. Lizz is a brilliant writer and comedian. She created The Daily Show and Air America. If you love Rachel Maddow and Al Franken, you have Lizz Winstead to thank for them. And she joins us today in Iowa City. Hello, Lizz Winstead.
David Feldman, thank you for having me.
It has been estimated that one-third of American women have had abortions in their lives. What's up with abortion?
People seem to hate it. I can't get it. So controversial. Calm down.
That was a super good, that was a good little synopsis that you did. The couple things that I would say is, when people say to me right off the bat, like, Liz, you've become really active in this movement, and if there was one thing you could say to people, what would it be? And the one thing I would say is being friends with some doctors whose lives have been threatened. I'm friends with Dr. David Gunn's son. He's a son of a gun.
Joey Bishop.
It is indeed true. Joey Bishop. that we just never refer to them as pro-life or their agenda as pro-life because these physicians are terrorized. Their clinics are bombed. They're blown up. They're set on fire. Dr. David Pillar was killed in his church. Dr. Slepian was killed in Buffalo, New York, making soup in his kitchen. These people are domestic terrorists, and they don't deserve to be normalized by saying that they have any consideration for life, because it seems like when you talk about women, they never come into the equation. So that's one thing I would say. Mm-hmm. And second of all, though, I really liked you talking about, you mentioned the 24-hour waiting periods that often people have to go through. And in many states, that's the best you get. Some states have 48 hours. Some states, people have to wait 72 hours because under the guise of women are just like, you know, frivolous shit bags who, you know, if our vaginas weren't regulated, they would just be wandering amok, you know, like some crazy Macy's balloon that got loose, you know, just like ravaging town or something. And so, you know, it's insulting and it's all just a crazy, crazy misogyny Ponzi scheme to get people to believe that people actually care about quote unquote babies when they don't. They just want to, you know, reiterate this concept that women are incompetents who don't ever think about anything seriously and we're just flibberty gibbets running around. So it's all bullshit. And so we just decided to do some comedy shows in these states that are really hard hit who desperately need folks to come and remind them that they're not isolated because they feel incredibly isolated and to help grow, you know, activists and grow their community base around the clinics. And, you know, as performers, Jesus, we can just come and do a show. You know, you get between 150 people in a room and 400 people in a room and you're real fun. And then you go, hey, will you guys spend a half an hour with us hearing about what's happening in your community? And once you do, sign up to help these folks because they need it. And they're like, okay. So it's really fun.
Tell me when you founded Lady Parts Justice League.
So what happened was about 5 years ago when our friend Mike Pence was still in Congress, I was back, I'm from Minnesota, and I was sort of figuring out what I was going to do next. Was I going to try to do another TV show so that I could get no credit for it? Or was I going to try to do something, you know, I didn't know. So somebody said maybe write a book. So I was trying to do that. And all of these laws started happening in the state legislatures, like literally 27 of them in the course of 3 months, where clinics were closing immediately. And the right has something that is, and I don't know how politically savvy your fans are, but, you know, we know about ALEC, the mm-hmm. legislative. So there is something that is sort of like ALEC that deals with abortion law, right? So they create model legislation, they get shitbag, dumb shit local legislators elected, and then they hand them this legislation, and then it just gets jammed through all these legislatures. And so it happened profoundly. And I was in Minnesota, and I was like, holy shit, I finished my book, and I needed to get back to Brooklyn. So I decided to drive home and do fundraisers along the way. It's like, oh, I can help out and do that. And when I was doing these fundraisers, I would stop in and visit the clinics, and they literally said to me, you know, no one ever comes here. Like, thank you for coming. People think we're toxic, and we treat people every single day, and we, you know, they come into us with, you know, 100 problems, and we can fix one of them. And that one problem that we can fix is literally, if we couldn't fix it, it would be oftentimes a crossroad between whether or not that person could function in society, be a good parent, actually get that college degree, like so many things, you know, you forget. Like that is somebody, whether or not you want to have a kid is your first decision a lot of times to your economic destiny.
You were driving back from Minnesota to Brooklyn. When you say you were going to do fundraisers, what do you just call abortion providers and say, hey, this is Lynn?
I mean, it's exactly what I did. You know, it's like, you know, I was like, you know, if I said, I'm Lizz Winstead, I want to come, I'm traveling across country with my two dogs and I want to come and do a fundraiser, they'd be like, you know what? We're going to call the police. But instead, you know, it was kind of like my friend Maggie, who is a dear friend of mine and she's a rock and roll booker, she was actually like, I've got some downtime. Let me help you book this tour. So she called up clinics and said, you know, Lizz Winstead, she's a comic. She created The Daily Show. She wants to come and, you know, help raise awareness because these laws are awful. So it wasn't just like some crazy vagabond who's like wandering into clinics right. going, you know, I want some booze. Let's raise some money.
Who's in the audience?
Just a town. You know, it's like a fundraiser. And so it's supporters of, this is what was interesting. It was, some were supporters of Planned Parenthood, some were people who were my comedy fans, and then some were like people who cared about abortion rights. And so the people who were supporters of Planned Parenthood didn't understand that, like, while we all love Planned Parenthood and should support them and talk about them, there's such a larger movement of abortion clinics in America. The independent community clinic provides 70% of all the abortions in our country.
Okay, slow down, This is stuff I know nothing about. And until I saw Janine from Des Moines, Jane Edith Wilson's movie, I didn't know that Planned Parenthood did mammograms and was where young girls went to get their hoo-hoo looked at, no questions asked. I don't mean to get all fancy with my Latin by calling it a hoo-hoo, but...
I practically thought you went to med school. Crazy. Like, David, talk to your audience. We all know you're smart.
This is what I said to Greg Proops. And you got to go really slowly with me on this stuff.
Okay.
Because because there's a men's room and a women's room. And that door is shut. So you got to help me out here. When you say Planned Parenthood, there are independent mom and pop abortion clinics that sprung up after Roe v. Wade?
Right? No, all clinics. There were clinics, you know, states made abortion legal before Roe, right? So pre-Roe, people were going to New York because the faith community in New York were the ones that legalized abortion in 1970 in the state of New York. Because the Jewish community and all these different faith-based groups were seeing their parishioners come into their local churches desperate, pregnant and desperate, and trying to perform some legal abortions, but a lot of it was trying to get rid of a pregnancy on their own and almost killing themselves. And so it was the faith community in New York that made abortion legal in 1970.
Really? The faith community?
Yeah. Absolutely. In fact, I just went to a celebration of the 40th anniversary of, I can't remember the name of the organization, but there was a big celebration at the Judson Church, and all these different people who are clergy in leadership told their stories and talked about what it was like and to really fight for abortion rights as a Christian belief, as a religious belief. In fact, I would highly recommend, there's an abortion provider named Dr. Willie Parker, who just came out with a book 2 months ago, who his whole book, it's a memoir. He's about growing up black in Birmingham, dirt poor, becoming an OBGYN, and he's a strict Baptist, and it's how his Baptist faith led him to the calling of abortion care because he believes being a Christian is about compassion. It's really a beautiful book, and it really puts what it means to service people, to help them, you know, live for their full humanity in a perspective that makes, like, really, really interesting sense. Yeah, he's a really cool dude.
How much help are you still getting from religious leaders?
Well, there's definitely groups. There's Catholics for Choice, and there's a great coalition of, you know, religious partners for abortion rights. But, you know, anybody fighting for it is just completely overshadowed by these monsters. And the monsters are such bullies that, quite frankly, in the fight for abortion access, I think we've ceded so much ground to their language, to how we feel about it, to caveats. You know, it's pretty horrifying. You know, so people say cavalierly, well, only 3% of what Planned Parenthood does is abortion. And I'm like, I don't care. If 100% of what they did was abortion, I wouldn't care. Because what that says to the physicians that provide it or the people that have had them is, you know, that dirty thing we do that you had done and that doctor does, that's only a little bit of what we do. Like, why should anyone care? If you believe it's baby killing, then that's your shit. I happen to believe in science. And so science tells me a different story.
Does the existence of Planned Parenthood make abortions fewer? In other words, planning your parenthood. Isn't the idea behind Planned Parenthood that abortion would be the thing you do after, you know, for the last resort? Is that a fair statement, or is that a Clinton-esque?
Yeah, I mean, I wouldn't even say, I mean, when we say, I mean, here's the deal. I'm sure they hate Planned Parenthood because it has the word planned in it. There's nothing a politician hates more than a plan, because that means you have to have a brain to actually execute it and have to be a good one. But, I mean, what I would say is, when we talk about things like last resort, or we talk about anything that has to do with behavioral things, I mean, who hasn't had sex without a condom and just kind of like went, oh, I really hope I'm not pregnant, and been freaked out? You know, who hasn't, you know, made mistakes on that kind of front? I don't want to shame anybody for how they got pregnant. I'm not interested in that. But I know that if somebody is pregnant and they profoundly feel they can't be, for whatever reason that is, they should have every opportunity to not be, and also not be judged or identified by the fact they had an abortion.
I'm thinking of the neoliberal Bill Clinton argument that he used in 92 that resonated with me, and that was, we can both agree, I'm getting a different answer from you, so we can both agree that there should be fewer abortions in this country, and the best way to guarantee that there are fewer abortions is education and Planned Parenthood and making sure that women understand their bodies. And you're, I think, saying F you to that. We don't need anybody telling us about our bodies. We want abortions. Is that kind of?
Well, yeah. Well, here's the deal. Since the history of forever, there has been abortion, right? People have had unintended pregnancies for whatever reason. What I would say to people is, when we say things like, and I'm not saying there shouldn't be fewer abortions, because, you know, it's especially in the climate we live in now, where it's like inaccessible to get one, when you have to go through, it's really expensive, you have to go through a throng of hoops, you have to be challenged constantly by government officials, you have to be lied to by doctors. I mean, the whole thing is crazy, right? But at the end of the day, let me ask you this. What is the ethical dilemma around abortion for you, David Feldman? Like, when you say we can all agree there should be less abortions, why would we all agree to that?
Well,
because it's murder, because it's unsafe, because it causes you to not be able to have other kids.
I have to have sex. And if I can't have sex, I'm going to masturbate. And if you showed me the Kleenex holding my sperm, and you performed an ultrasound, and it had a heartbeat, I would say, ooh, I definitely hear a heartbeat from that Kleenex. I'm going to try not to masturbate. And then 6 hours later, well, you know, I'm going to masturbate because I cannot, or I'm going to have sex because I have to. Hang on for 1 second, okay?
I'm with you.
All right. It is conventional wisdom that women, I'm going to make a joke. I'm going to be careful here. Because
I'm on your podcast. Please step in it. I can't wait.
No, I'm in so much trouble with women. You have no idea. You have no idea how much trouble I'm in.
Oh, I probably have an idea. I've known you for fucking 40 years. Like, wait, breaking news, David Feldman is in trouble with women.
I have.
So now he's going to school me on some Clinton-esque bullshit abortion shamey stuff. But no, keep going about how jerking off is something you need to do. No, really, this is helpful.
Okay. And by the way, you know, I'm pretty much divorced. And the way I proposed to my first wife was, I dropped to one knee and I said, I hate you slightly less than I hate all other women on the planet. Will you marry me?
And she did.
And she did. So. Anyway, so I think, and I'm just saying, you know, this is, I think a lot of men might think that mm-hmm. women don't, I'm going to move on.
No, please. That women don't need to jerk off as much as men?
Or need sex as much as men, and they control. This is not what I think, because I'm a, as you know, an enlightened man.
So far, proving it profoundly, keeping it 100, right here on this podcast.
That this is a conservative older man viewpoint that women can control their sexual appetites better than men can. That's what men believe. Not all men.
But here's what's hilarious about that is that it's just hilarious. But second of all, there's some reason that women, if that were true, let's say that were true, your weird thing was true that you just said. Like, let's just pretend that wasn't embarrassing. why should they?
You
just told me a whole 5-minute story about how you would be jerking off in the shower, and then if you're in the, or no, you weren't even in the shower, you're jerking off into a Kleenex, probably was off-brand even, it didn't have aloe, you're just jerking off into some, probably sandpaper actually, not Kleenex at all. So your cock is in sandpaper. And then when you hear this heartbeat of the sandpaper sperm, you're like, wow, I probably shouldn't do that, but I'm still going to shove my cock into the sandpaper constantly. But here's the deal, Liz, women just don't want to fuck guys a lot who would just shove their cock into sandpaper. Now, I think the problem is that men are constantly trying to come up with rationalizations why women don't want to fuck them more, and maybe it's because they stick their dick in sandpaper and then wonder if it has a heartbeat. I don't know. That's just a theory.
Right, and it's all... But okay, so I'm gonna put another foot in the shed here. Okay,
both feet... Okay, really good so far.
Okay.
I feel like I'm winning, so I'm killing
it. Of course you're winning. You have no idea what... You have no idea what a loser I am with women right now. As though
yeah, right now, because you know, before it was just you were just laying me down in a bed of roses.
I would say that men have an ego and they think, well, she doesn't want to have sex with me, so obviously, I mean, you know, it's like lesbo, that's the, you know, the joke, but it's also obviously she would have sex with me, but she can control her animal spirits. That's the nature of women. They don't always have to have sex. They're in control of the whole sexual thing that's going on, unless they're being raped. That's what I think.
They just don't always have to have sex with men, and men can't. By the way, I just want to remind you that we're doing a podcast on the Magical Mystery Tour, and for the past 10 minutes, we've just centered men around my whole fucking thing. I can't even fucking believe you took me on your shit bath of a story. Liz, I really want to talk to you about your good work, but let's just talk about men and how we can't stop jerking off for about 30 minutes. Then we'll plug your thing at the end.
Guilty.
But I like your theories. I think they're fun.
Okay. All right. Lady Parts Justice League, I have a lot of questions or issues.
Yeah.
I think I have issues.
Okay.
I think I have issues.
Okay, good. Let me see if I can clear some of them up for you. Including why women don't want to fuck you. If you want to get back to that, I'm all for it.
I think there's an epidemic of lesbianism. They all just don't want to fuck me. This is the problem.
That could be. I would say you could call that an epidemic, or you just call that Tuesday.
Okay. So we do some important work here because we're having fun, but I want to do important work here. LPJL.
Lady Parts Justice League.
Lady Parts Justice League. And I am sweating. I am really nervous. I really am, because the Magical Mystery Tour, how do people, and then I want to ask you some questions.
Okay.
How do people help the Lady Parts Justice League? How do they reach you? How can they support you? And how can they support women who are having trouble getting abortions?
How they can support us, you know, you can go to ladypartsjusticeleague.com. We have a donate button. We also have a bunch of ways on our website listed that you can help reach out to independent abortion providers, and you can help out with the people who are really vital ancillary support for clinics, whether they're escorts who work helping patients come in and out to walk through those throngs of screaming vaginal crossing guards who stand outside of clinics all the time, who think that they know better than you about your mm-hmm. body. a lot of times, many states have set up abortion funds for low-income women who might need help getting their procedures or help with travel, because so many states, your Medicaid won't cover your procedure. It'll cover many other things, but it won't cover your procedure. And so you can do that. We have a postcard program where you can just, you know, we have on the website a list of independent abortion providers, and you can just like either download postcards from our site, or you can go buy some postcards and just send notes of encouragement and support. You know, you can get in contact with the clinic that's near you. And that might not necessarily be a Planned Parenthood. It might be one of these community clinics we were talking about, and reach out and say, hey, you know what? I would love to meet with you. You can screen me, and I'd love to, you know, take your staff out for drinks twice a year. I'd love to bring you cupcakes. I'd love to invite you publicly into my social space to let you know that I'm supporting you publicly and in the light. You know, things like that really matter to them. So when you say, how can you support us? One of the things we do on our tour is that we go to each clinic and we assess their needs. Like, a lot of times people forget they can't get a contractor to do their lawn or fix their roof because they provide abortion. And so what we do a lot of times is we'll go in and we'll do some repair work around their place. We'll plant a garden, we'll paint a fence, we'll plant bushes, we'll do shredding for them. You know, companies won't come and just do like normal things a company needs, or we'll find local people and bring them together to help them do their stuff. A lot of places need a handyman. So, you know, any skill you have, people who are at your clinic would probably need it and could be able to use it. And so if you come to our show in one of the cities that we're traveling in, you'll see a really funny comedy show. You'll hear some music. And then we have a talk back with a person that runs the clinic and then somebody who is part of one of the activist teams. And they'll tell you what you need, and you can sign up right there, meet them, talk to them, and start building a relationship right there. So those are many things you can do. And if you're a comic, you could join us on the road at any point. We do this throughout the year. This is like a really concentrated 16 cities in 8 weeks tour. But we do pockets. But also, if you're just in a town and doing a club, you could totally offer 4 tickets to your show to the local clinic and say, you know what? I want to give you some comps. You guys deserve to have a fun night out. Like, that's easy.
Most Americans are pro-choice, right?
Yes, 70%.
So I'm working off this article that was in last month's New York Review of Books because I'm an effete intellectual snob. They wrote a review of 2 new books out about abortion.
What were the books?
You know, I don't have them in front of me. I have my notes from the New York Review of Books on my...
I bet Willie Parker's book was one of them.
I don't know. I'm working off my cheat sheet, and these facts are cited from the New York Review of Books.
Well, so far you're killing it on the facts. Those are correct.
Right. So according to the New York Review of Books, it's conventional wisdom among men that women suffer severe depression and loss of self-esteem after an abortion. In fact, Anthony Kennedy, the Supreme Court Justice, actually wrote that, I believe, in Casey versus Planned Parenthood.
Yes.
Is that?
He did. And what was interesting about that, first of all, that's medically disproven because you're not studying the psychology of a person before they have their procedure. So they could have come in with depression and mental illness if they're experiencing those things. People may experience loss after a termination or even depression. But does that make it society's problem to, you know what I mean? Like, that can't, somebody who has, people have depression over bad plastic surgery too.
Or like, after having a baby. They have postpartum depression.
Yeah, exactly. Not my problem. But for the most part, that's a scientifically... It's an unprovable thing where they're actually, the University of San Francisco did a like 5-year research study on the effects of what happens when a woman is denied abortion care. And that is startling. The depression, what happens to their life is really incredible. In fact, and the one thing that I really think is interesting about the Supreme Court case that you cited in Kennedy's ruling is that in this ruling, there was the people who were bringing the case, and what Casey was, for people who don't know, what Planned Parenthood v. Casey did was, after Roe v. Wade became the law of the land, the states, and Bob Casey, a Democrat who's anti-choice from Pennsylvania, said, well, should we just have a woman have total control over her body? I mean, shouldn't the state have some say for her own good? And so they presented the argument that the states should have, should be able to curb access to abortion for the benefit of the pregnant person. And what the Supreme Court ruled was that you could create these caveats if you didn't, quote, cause an undue burden. Well, that you could drive a truck, Mack truck, through that hole, because what the fuck does that mean? And, you know, and so they started these waiting periods and all this stuff. And what swayed Casey to vote with the majority in that was there was many women who had abortions, like 100, who filed amicus briefs saying, after my abortion, I felt depression. After my abortion, I felt regret. And no one from the pro-choice side filed any briefs at all saying, my abortion saved my life. My abortion gave me my destiny. It let me go to college.
So that's what convinced Justice Kennedy to write.
Yes, exactly.
And they have found that women actually feel something far different from depression and loss of self-esteem after an abortion, haven't they?
Relief is the number one thing that most women say they feel. Absolutely. 100%. And so we just had a ruling when these laws got really bad, and most people are most familiar with the Texas law, which was that horrible law in Texas happened in some version in 27 other states around the country the same year it happened in Texas, when Wendy Davis filibustered and stood up and did all that. And the Supreme Court threw that law out last year. And in the oral arguments, they had hundreds of women filing amicus briefs talking about the very thing that didn't happen in Casey. All these really beautiful stories of how women having access to abortion helped them become better mothers. Because 65% of all women who have abortions already have one or more kids, and they've just made a decision that they can't have another kid. You know, it's the stereotype that one puts into their head, that it's some young single woman who is like some big whore walking around, is not actually the actual prototypical person having abortion. So it's pretty fascinating when you start digging into the details and the facts around it, and how much shit is thrown around it. And the other thing that's pretty interesting is the sort of that big Hobby Lobby case that happened, where, you know, the Christian craft store who decided they didn't want to cover certain birth controls with their employees because they said they were abortions. They said an IUD is an abortion. Mm-hmm. It's ridiculous. But when that case was argued, had there not been women on the court, the presentation in that argument, there was 57 incorrect statements about how you get pregnant, what happens when a fertilized egg travels into the uterus, what the timing of that is, like what birth control does. I mean, the arguments themselves were an abortion, because it was like the women had to call out these lawyers so many times, and the men on the court just sat there, and they would have just taken in all this misinformation.
Absolutely.
And you know, and that's the part that's so insane.
Yes. By the way, Hobby Lobby, when this was being decided, it was revealed that they don't provide maternity leave.
No, they don't. Also, they're bullshit because they act like first of all, you can't be a Christian store. You're a store. You're not a person. You're a store. And second of all, you know that they're bullshit line of Christianity. It's just once you're having a great sex, you're just crafting goes way down. So they were just like, we just can't have people jump out of crafting. We have to make sure they're crafting. So let's have them have less sex, more decoupage.
I want it.
Not a popular t-shirt.
Hobby Lobby was also what Phyllis Schlafly called her, you know what. So let me play devil's advocate here.
Okay.
Would you say that personal responsibility is a consistent viewpoint with the Republicans in that they believe if you don't work hard, you should die from lack of health care? They believe this. They don't want to admit
100%.
It. 100%. Right?
Well, they've actually said no one's ever died from lack of health care. So it's like so far beyond the pale. But yeah, they do believe that.
So I'm just looking for consistency so that we can't accuse the Republicans of being disingenuous about abortion. We'll get to control and misogyny and jealousy of women. But there are some people who believe that in America, it's all about personal responsibility. And if you get pregnant, it's your responsibility to raise the child. And you should have thought about it before you got pregnant. And this is all about personal responsibility. Is that a fair statement that the conservatives really do believe that?
Well, I think they do believe it. But what I would say about that statement is, so it's not personally responsible to assess your own life and decide that you would be a horrible parent. And so you would like an abortion. You know, that makes that it's an argument that holds no water with me, because they say it all the time. I mean, I've had people say to me, it's about personal responsibility. What are you going to say to the person who's like, had been pregnant three times and had three abortions? I'm like, maybe if they can't get it together to get birth control, they shouldn't be parents. That seems like a really stupid person who would keep, if they keep having abortions, I say thank you from myself and society. Because the personal responsibility part, it goes back for me, is that it's not my job in the world to be judging people on whether or not they're sexually responsible. If they want an abortion, they should have one, because it's safe. It's not going to prohibit them from ever having kids if and when they choose to. It doesn't cause any breast cancer. It doesn't destroy any amount of fertility or infertility. And if people want to have them, it's not going to be physically harmful to them. And so what the fuck do I care if somebody wants to go spend $400 on having an abortion or spend, I just don't care. I mean, you could say, you know what, using a condom's probably smart because it would help you prevent STDs and help you prevent from getting pregnant. Yes, of course. Absolutely. But it's like we make a lot of assumptions like people aren't married. You know, it's like, what's your responsibility? Well, if you're married and have a couple of kids and you can't have another one, are you supposed to not have sex with your husband anymore when you've had enough kids because of the risk of having one you can't afford or don't have the capacity to take care of? I mean, it's also bizarre because the second we start saying personal responsibility, we stop talking about abortion. You know, the argument around abortion should be it should be around the science of gestation and abortion, not around anything else.
Okay. But you do agree that there are some people who genuinely are against abortion because they believe they're wrong, but they do believe in personal responsibility. They're not.
Yes, I do not think that you're making up fictitious people. I meet those people every day. They call me a whore on Twitter every day. I know them intimately. In fact, they're some of my biggest fans. Yeah. They'll yell at me like, how many abortions have you had? And I'm like, I don't know. I don't save receipts. Like, I'm very disorganized. No idea.
I want to talk to you about that tone in a second.
Okay.
Because it's for a guy my age. Let me get to that in a second. You escort.
For a guy your age who jerks off into sandpaper. let's put your morality into context again. Bring it on back.
I'm going to step back into it in a second. Before we get to your tone of voice and the way Jennifer.
I like my tone, young lady.
Because I want to talk about how Jennifer was perceived on Greg's Proopcast when she talked to these quote-unquote pro-lifers. But very quickly, you escort these women from their cars through the phalanx of right-wing nuts.
Mm-hmm.
What do you think is more traumatic? Having an abortion, we've just pretty much agreed that Justice Kennedy is wrong, that women who have abortions say they experience relief. So what is more traumatic, an abortion or walking to the clinic to get the abortion?
Well, you know, that's I don't know that it's an either or thing, only because, you know, the trauma of having to terminate a pregnancy, you know, just like anything else, there's people who have many different feelings about it, you know. So I'm not going to disregard.
Didn't before she died say that?
Yeah, she way before she became somebody who, Jane Roe became somebody who then became part of the anti-choice movement. And there's people who are like me who've had an abortion who could not have given a shit about it. But then there's people And then there was people who had wanted pregnancies who, because of a fetal anomaly or because of, it would have taken their life, you know, had these really painful abortions. And then there's people who have moral conflicts about it where they know it's really good for their family and they know it's what they need to do. But they felt like they have religious conflict or moral conflict. So people do have feelings about their abortion, right? And you can't legislate how someone's going to feel about something. You can only legislate whether or not a procedure is safe, should be legal for everyone. And, you know, at the end of the day, you know, no one should drink. If some people have a drink and then foolishly drive and, you know, get in an accident, you know, you just can't legislate that shit.
You can't legislate it, but we can create a culture that instills a sense of shame.
Absolutely. And that's part of what we do at LPJL is to try to bust back mm-hmm. on that shame and stigma. So when you ask me about whether it's either or, you know, I think the thing for me that was really profound was it takes an amount of privilege to be able to be an escort. You can take time off of work, and so it's mostly white women who are escorting, oftentimes women of color, from their car past white dudes who are yelling at them. So you have me, a white woman, walking in a woman of color as some guardian for her, which is, you know, kind of weird on some level, and then walking by a bunch of men who are telling her she shouldn't have control over her own body. And historically, that's incredibly fucked up, I don't need to say. But when you think about how many times a person of color has been reminded of that throughout their day, every day, on a really shitty day for that person who has to make a pretty tough decision, it's real fucked up. You know, it's real fucked up that these people think that they have the right to stand out there and scream at women of color, telling them that they're, you know, creating a black genocide and destroying their own race. And, you know, it's really profound when you hear it. And it's really unbelievable to think that people think they have a power over another person in that regard. We bought mirrors to hold up to them so they could look at themselves
wow.
when they were yelling at the women.
Wow.
Yeah. You know, because sometimes you just try to figure out how to shake them. And I think the thing that's really the most astounding is when you have a lot of those people yelling and how you really know it's that they don't really care about pregnancy or they don't really think it's a baby. When I and a bunch of women standing outside of a clinic can distract the self-professed carers of the infant, so much so that, for example, when we were in Mississippi and Greg and I were talking to these people for an hour and a half, you know, 13 or 14 women went into their appointments without being harassed because they would rather yell at a woman and tell her how stupid she is face to face, you know, instead of getting to the matter at hand of trying to convince somebody to not go have their abortion. you know? And so the second you realize it's so easy to have them lecturing you instead of being really focused and determined to try to get someone to stop having an abortion because they believe it's a baby, then you just know they're all bullshit.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's like, you know, if I can stand outside of a clinic and talk to some guy and make him feel like, oh, hey, it's cool because I found this really great religion that says I can use God to sit there and tell women they're whores. This is like the best thing ever. It's just like you are sitting here telling me I'm a whore. When A, if I was a whore, I would be working, blowing guys for money. And B, you obviously don't understand that, or you would call me something else.
I have daughters, okay?
Yes.
And so...
they can call me.
Yes. And I have sons, and I...
he can call me.
I was raised... I was a red diaper baby, and I raised my kids to agree with everything you're saying. Okay? Let me get to your tone of voice.
Okay.
The thing from Greg's Proopcast, and by the way, I want to plug your podcast as well. What's the name of your podcast?
It's called Repro Madness. It's a weekly wrap-up of all of these crazy laws that just exist around access to abortion.
Oh my God, that sounds great. I haven't heard
it. It's really fun. It's funny. It's great. It's funny. You know, it's very palatable. It's the outrage of, and you know, these locals talk about it. I mean, when you hear the shitstorm of what these people say, I mean, it's incredible. I mean, just last week, a state legislator in Missouri didn't want to fund the zoo unless they called it the anti-abortion zoo. And that's just like one story. And there's like a bazillion of them that we tell every week. But anyway, let's get back to my tone.
Yeah, let's get back to your tone of voice.
Okay.
So I'm a dinosaur. And I know to vote the right way. This is what both feet are in the shit right now.
Okay.
After Hillary lost, this is what men said. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
This is what men said. Maybe Lena Dunham and Lizz Winstead lost the election for us because of their tone. You've heard that, right?
Of course.
Okay.
Here's what I love. Can I just...
sure, go ahead.
Is there more to say about that?
Sure, sure. Go ahead. No, go ahead.
I love that people would say that maybe Lena Dunham and Lizz Winstead lost the election for Hillary because of their tone. When the guy who won was like grabbing pussy for a living. So I'm not gonna really carry the mantle of Hillary's defeat because I want people to have abortions because Donald Trump grabbed them by the pussy and then shoved his cock inside of them and got them pregnant. Sorry. I'm not really going to take that. I'm keeping my tone. I'm not going to go there. But I have heard, on a super serious note, though, for real.
That's funny, yeah. But it's super serious.
It is super serious. You know, I mean, and that's the part that's just so crazy when I've heard that, too. And it was like, and I was a Bernie supporter, you know, and then I supported Hillary after Bernie. But and then just to hear Tom Perez and Bernie Sanders, you know, endorsing this mayoral candidate who was a very anti-choice candidate who put a bunch of dangerous laws in place in Nebraska, saying, you know, maybe abortion is an issue where we can compromise. Maybe, you know, the right to choose is a place where we can find, you know, and it's like, I'm sorry, you can't be sort of pregnant. Therefore, you can't have sort of options. And for someone to literally not understand this and say, why are you talking about abortion when people care about economics? If you do not fundamentally understand how pregnancy is an economic issue, then you need to like go back to the home and eat your pudding and, you know, watch reruns of Hardcastle and McCormick. Or I don't even know why I said that. I've never even said those words in my life. But because you don't understand humanity and you can relegate reproductive access as to being a woman's issue and not something that you should care about. And dudes need to care about it because it's like all of us. If you have daughters and people in your life and you think that they deserve every fucking avenue of destiny and to fail on their faces on their own terms, then damn straight, you better make sure that there is not a roadblock in sight for that person with a uterus in your life. And so you better fight for it.
Okay. So this is how my daughters were raised and my sons around the dinner table. I'm sarcastic. I provoke. And I would jokingly say that, and then I want to get back to tone, okay? Because I'm having problems with tone of voice.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to read you some facts that I got from the New York Review of Books, and this is stuff that was thrown around at the dinner table. We gave African Americans the right to vote. It took 50 years after to give women the right to vote. Until 1936. Women could lose their American citizenship if they moved overseas and then married a non-citizen. There was a time when children could become a citizen if only their father was a citizen, but they couldn't become citizens if only their mothers were citizens. And I used to say stuff like, why do you put up with this shit? Like, why are you, what's wrong? I would provoke my daughters and my son. What's wrong with women that they would take this shit from men, right? Well, now it turns out they're not taking this shit from men anymore. They never took it. Well, some of them took it. The point I'm making is I have noticed in my personal life that several women have said to me, if you don't understand, I'm not explaining it to you. Get out of my way. You're irrelevant. I don't care if you don't understand it. I'm not explaining it to you. Drop dead.
Oh, I think that is dumb. And I think that's what second wave feminism did. And I think that...
So there is a philosophy. You say it's second wave feminism that says if you're too stupid to understand this, go die.
No, I don't think I said that. I think you said that. And I think what I was going to say was what second wave feminism did was say, we don't want to hear from men. And I think that you can't win any fight that's worth that all humanity benefits from, even if it happens just to me or if it just happens to brown people or if it just happens to Jews or whatever, The fight needs to be with everyone understanding that if we all do not have our basic humanity, then no one really has their basic humanity. And I think there was women's movement, I don't want to hear from men when it comes to this issue. And it's like, I think the tone and the tide and the change needs to be, we need men to fully realize that full humanity, we need to support full humanity for women. And what that means is we need to step up and stand next to people and support women in this fight instead of being like, this is a woman's fight and a woman's issue and I don't want to hear from a man. I do want to hear from a man who's defending women's issues. I think it's important, but I think that instead of hearing, I don't need to only hear from men or I don't need to be mansplained, but I would love to, have more men, hear, listen, be part of it, stand up, have fun, understand that we're all happier, we all have better lives if everybody is feeling equal.
Martin Luther King said the enemy of progress is the sane, rational incrementalist who is all for progress but just slow it down a little.
Well, I think and if you want to even bastardize King a little bit more, I think the one thing he said that rings true a lot for me is, and I'm not saying it correctly, but it's really not the horrible monsters who are going to destroy us. It's going to, it's not the loud monsters that will destroy us. It's the appalling silence of the good people,
Right.
It's the people who sit back and care and say they're going to do something. Because if you just sit back and care and call yourself a whole bunch of, identify in a bunch of ways, but never stand up, what good are you? Because it's not just voting against bad legislation. It's a, it's, you know, who's proposing proactive legislation to expand access to birth control and to abortion, and you know, who's doing that? You know, there's a couple people in the Progressive Caucus in Congress, but not really anybody. California just did a thing, but that's about it.
What did California do?
I think that they did a couple of things. They passed a law that said that this is a whole other episode, but around the country there are something called crisis pregnancy centers, which are fake abortion clinics run by Christians, and
they get federal funding.
They get state funding. There's 4,000 of them compared to the 790 actual healthcare centers that there are. And they're just evil and crazy. And they can lie to you about the statistics, and they do. They'll show you fake ultrasounds that is not the gestational age of your pregnancy. They separate you from your phone when you're in this fake exam. I mean, it's just the worst. So California passed something that said it was illegal to run a clinic or to give medical advice that was not based in science. So that's pretty cool.
Mm-hmm. Good.
I like that. Yeah. So that was a good thing. So occasionally here and there we have stuff.
Okay.
Expanding sex education in states that allow you.
You're going to come back, I hope.
Come back to your podcast?
Yes.
Anytime. I love it.
This is,
you know, I would like to just hang out with you too at some point. Like the fact that, like, I saw you in the Minneapolis airport like 7 years ago, and it's like now I've talked to you on your podcast. This is not a way to have a friendship. It's sort of bullshit, actually.
I know. I'm not going to be a pig. I'm going to let you go because they're.
Because you got to go jerk off into your sandpaper.
How do you know I haven't been doing it while you were talking in that tone that I secretly love? Am I in trouble?
Yeah, you probably do get an erection. No, but you know what's really crazy? You say that. We videotaped a guy who was Joyelle Johnson, who was part of our team, incredibly funny comic. She's like almost 6 feet tall, black woman, super smart and funny. And she was talking to a protester, and we had a camera crew with us, and she's talking to the protester, and someone's camera, they were just holding their camera down and they were filming, and they filmed the guy getting an erection while he was shaming Joyelle. It was fucked up.
Yeah,
that's actually part of it.
My inner Falwell.
Oh, your inner Falwell. Let's go there.
I'm a politician, by the way. I've realized that I'm guilty of being in a bubble and thinking like a politician by saying things like, when you're being shoved into the oven by the Nazi, don't you have a responsibility to understand why he's shoving you into the oven?
Exactly. That's the part that I love. It's like, you really should look at both sides of why they care. Why should I do that? They are irrational, crazy people who don't have a side. The only side is science. Any other side is shit that is not my concern.
Right. And Obama kind of encourages that. You know, don't hate the hater. Try to understand. I listened to my conversation with Greg Proops, and I asked, how do you tell a toothless white man living in his car when he's standing outside an abortion clinic? How do you ask him to check his white privilege? And that is a legitimate question if you're a neoliberal, if you're an Obama supporter, even a Clinton supporter, even a Bernie supporter. And Greg's silence was like a silent scream, if you'll pardon that reference. Like, it's like, what That's the horrible. F are you talking about? Who cares? You know, if you're standing blocking an abortion clinic and screaming at women, I don't care that you can't get a job. You're traumatized.
So you know what? If you're standing in front of an abortion clinic screaming at women, you aren't looking for a job.
Or that is your job.
There are no job applications.
Are these
people? Or you are paid. There are many people that are paid. Yes, indeed. When they talk all about the people paid by George Soros, no one's paid by George Soros to go protest. I would love some Soros money. Mm-hmm. But these people I know for a fact get paid. Yeah, absolutely.
So I think some men have an inner Jerry Falwell. And I want to ask...
Or an outer. But yeah.
I think the misogyny, I think you talk about the misogyny. I want you to speak to this. There is a misogyny behind the pro-life movement. men, some men, are sexual.
The anti-choice movement.
Yes, the anti-choice movement. They are sexually frustrated men. Sexually frustrated men who deep down inside say, if I can't get laid, and I'm telling, not that this makes it better by confessing this to you, and I don't think all men have this, but there is a little part of me that says, if I can't get laid, then the people who are getting laid should suffer. I see it in myself. So how much do you think of this, like this inner Jerry Falwell in me, is the pro-life movement writ large?
Where the anti-choice movement.
I'm sorry.
Gonna keep correcting.
Yes,
you.
Okay.
I think that that's, here's the deal. Anybody, I have to agree, because anybody who's had good sex is trying to have it again.
Mm-hmm.
So if you can like tell people to not have sex, you really reveal a lot about who you are, because it's like, how could you possibly say that if you've ever had sex that was worth a damn? I mean, wow, you just really, or you just
jealous,
have jealous, or you are a compulsive weirdo who has no impulse control whatsoever. And so you have to try to demonize sex and make everyone stop having it, so that, because left to your own devices, you would probably be having sex with like minors or some creepy ass other non-consenting thing. And I don't want to hear about it. And so they're like freaked out.
You live in Brooklyn, right?
Yeah.
Okay. There's this amazing party going on downstairs. There are young people, they're drinking, they're smoking dope, they're attractive, they're making out in the hallway, they're having sex, they're having the time of their lives. It's Saturday night, and I'm upstairs with my Kindle reading the Korematsu decision, and I want to call the police, not because they're making too much noise for me to focus on the Korematsu Supreme Court decision. I want to call the police and say, there are people who are having fun, and I'm not. Come and break it up. I think, to some degree, that's the anti-choice movement writ large.
Because except they're saying, I want to get on your lawn. I want to get on your lawn. Like the pro-choice people should be saying, get off my fucking lawn. Like, literally, get off my lawn.
How do people reach you?
They reach me. You can find me on Twitter at Lizz Winstead. You can go to Lady Parts Justice League. We're real fun on Twitter. You can get a lot of information. It's hilarious. And that's LPJ League on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook. And go to our website and check out and see what we do. It's like, it's kind of fun to be just this group of people who are telling jokes and trying to do some good in the world. And it's working.
Mm-hmm. And Iowa City, is the corn as high as the... Well, I'm as corny as Kansas in August.
In August.
Is it as high as the moon in the month of July?
No, dude, the corn here is just bullshit until, like, July. Yeah, knee high by the 4th of July. And then it's not really that good until right after the 4th. I'm from Minnesota. I can tell you all about corn.
Thank you, Lizz. Can you stay on the line for 1 second?
Yeah.
Thank you.
You're listening to highlights from The David Feldman Show, heard nationwide on Pacifica Radio, or as a podcast on iTunes, Stitcher, and now YouTube. Please subscribe to this channel. For more information, go to davidfeldmanshow.com. Thank you for listening.
The David Feldman Radio Program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.